So biologists have identified that this particular region of the protein is especially important for this abnormal behavior. And furthermore, that if we have a small molecule swimming around in our bodies as well, and that attaches to this particular region, if it comes close to the protein, then the abnormal behavior is stopped and the usual function of the protein can be restored. So we see that, well, first of all, this attachment, this is what we call binding. And we see that if we are able to predict the structure in which a small molecule binds to a protein, then this would be really helpful for drug discovery, right? So this is exactly the task that we tackled in our Equivine paper, where as the input, we have a protein with its 3D structure and a small molecule without the 3D structure. And what we want to predict is the 3D structure that the small molecule will take on during binding and its location with respect to the protein, right? So it's two tasks almost. We want to predict the conformational change of the small molecule, right? Because we only have the molecule as input without its 3D structure, and we want to find out which 3D structure it will take on. But we also want to predict where it will end up with respect to the protein. I hope that's clear. And whenever something's not clear, please feel free to raise your hand or just interrupt me. I'm happy to take questions or hear points from your side whenever. All right. But when tackling this task, we have some symmetries that we want our model to respect. So for example, we generate an initial guess what the 3D structure of the small molecule could be, but then no matter where we place this initial guess in space, right, whether it's here, here, or here, we always want to end up making the same prediction. So we want to be invariant with respect to the translation and rotation of the initial molecule structure. Right? So we want to be independent of the initial molecule placement for our prediction. Okay, and this is something that can actually be achieved with a tool from another work, Equidoc, where we first process both of these structures with graph neural networks. And if I should say some words about graph neural networks, please just mention it in the chat, for example, and I'm happy to talk about that. But yeah. If we're all familiar with graph neural networks, then we can just say that we process both of these structures that we represent as graphs, where the atoms of the small molecule are the nodes on our ligand graph or our small molecule graph, and the edges are given by bonds or the based on the distances between the atoms. And on the protein side, we build the graph based on amino acids, which are these building blocks of small molecules out of which the proteins are built. Yeah, and then we have these two graphs. We process them with graph neural networks, passing messages inside the two structures and between the two structures. And then we end up with final representations. And these final representations we use together with an attention mechanism over the coordinates of the structures to construct these key points, which are supposed to summarize where to summarize the small molecule and where the model thinks that the small molecule should go inside of the protein. And then, because we have the same number of key points on the ligand side and on the protein side, right? These were constructed with our attention mechanism, and based on how many attention heads we have, this determines the number of key points. So we just have the same number of attention heads for both structures. So we now have the same number of key points for both structures, and we have a correspondence between these key points. This means that we have these two point clouds that correspond to each other, and we can use the CAPTCHA algorithm or an algorithm called the CAPTCHA algorithm to calculate the optimal translation and rotation that we would need to apply to the point cloud to match these point clouds up as closely as possible in terms of RMSD. Yeah, and then of course we can just go ahead and apply this rotation and translation to the small molecule and end up with our final prediction. which is independent of our initial placement, right? All right, and whenever there are some questions about this, feel free to mention it. And if we do this, then we would always be treating our small molecule as a rigid object. But this does not correspond to reality at all, where a small molecule could take on many, many possible 3D structures. And especially during binding, it also changes its 3D structure, right? And molecules are flexible objects, or the 3D structure is something flexible and does not stay fixed at all. So we want to model this flexibility during binding to actually have a useful model in the end that we could use in practice, right? Because in practice, we don't initially know the 3D structure that the small molecule will take on when it is bound. All right, so what we do to model this flexibility is that, first of all, that's the initial step, in our graph neural network layers, we allow the graph neural network layers to additionally update the coordinates of the small molecule with each step. Right? So now we don't only change our hidden features, we also change the coordinates with each step, with something like EGNN, if you heard this, the equivalent graph neural networks. Yeah, and now we also know that not every coordinate change is chemically plausible or makes physical sense. So we want to model, we want to restrict our model towards making these only these coordinate changes that make sense, right? Because then we restrict the class of functions that we're modeling, we incorporate this prior knowledge, we need less data to train our model, and we're able to generalize better across these instances that actually make physical sense. All right, so we introduce like multiple different methods to introduce or to bring this chemically plausible flexibility modeling into our method. And here we, let's first of all look again at how we actually do our coordinate changes in this small illustration here, right? Because we have our small molecule that we encode into these blue nodes in this graph right here. And in the bottom, the red nodes, they should show the protein. And then we always pass messages inside of the protein and inside of the small molecule, but also these green messages between the two structures. Yeah, and after every update layer of the features in our small molecule, so the blue nodes, we also change the coordinates of the blue molecule based on the distances there. But so these messages, right, inside of the small molecule, let's maybe switch to this visualization. These messages inside of the small molecule, they are always associated with the distances between the two atoms. Also, the messages inside of the protein graph, they are always associated with the distances between the amino acids. However, the messages that we pass between the two structures, they don't get the distances, right? Because otherwise we would not be independent of the initial placement of the ligand. I hope that makes sense. Otherwise, just shoot me a question in the chat and we'll go over it in more detail. But now to how we restrict ourselves to make only changes that are chemically plausible. So here in this tool that we introduce, we use the prior knowledge from chemistry that during binding, the distances between atoms that are only one edge or two edges apart in the molecular graph, these distances almost don't change at all during binding and stay very rigid. It is only the distances that are three or more edges apart in the distances between atoms that are three or more edges apart in the molecular graph that change a lot during binding. So to build this prior knowledge to our model, we introduce a correction layer where we say that the one edge and two edge distances of the transformed coordinates after a GNN layer, these one edge and two edge distances, they should be the same as the one edge and two edge distances before the GNN layer, right? And then we use this term and gradient descent to change our transform coordinates after the GNN layer to match this objective more closely, okay? And here is now a visualization of what this looks like. On the left, we have an original molecule with the realistic bond lengths and bond angles. And on the right, there's the molecule after one GNN layer. And here we can see in this ring, these bond distances, they are really far too long and don't make, aren't physically plausible at all. And here is now an animation of what it looks like if we run our correction layer, right? So we have the GNN layer, and now we animate how it looks like if we run our correction layer. Yeah, and again. And we can see that afterwards, we really have a much better or much more realistic bond distances or bond lengths. Here in this ring, for example, the atoms are now much closer together, and this makes much more physical sense. So with this correction layer, you can almost imagine like a batch normalization layer, but not for the features. Instead, it's for the coordinates, ensuring that within our network, throughout our network, we always stay within more chemically plausible atom configuration, and our network always reasons about more physically plausible structures. Okay, and then another tool that we introduce is that afterwards, right, we only, after all of these GNN layers and we changed our coordinates, we always have this soft constraint or the soft correction layer that changes our coordinates to be more chemically plausible, but it does not strictly enforce that, for example, only the three hop distances or the three edge distances in the molecular graph are changed. So what we do is that we take the point cloud that we produce, which we see here in red. This is now the point cloud that is the output of our GNN, right? And we take it and we take the original molecule, the bond lengths and distances of the original molecule, and we only change the torsion angles, which means only changing the, which means keeping the one edge and two edge distances fixed. Yeah, we only change the torsion angles to match this point cloud as closely as possible. And then this is the final 3D structure prediction that we produce. And here is also, again, a visualization of what this looks like, where on the left, we have the molecule after all of our GNN layers. And they look kind of okay, but especially here at the bottom, I think we can see that these rings are far too squashed together and the bond lengths are a bit too short. And after we do this efficient torsion angle point cloud fitting step that is very fast, then we end up with structures that really look like realistic molecules. And these are then what we fit into the protein with this key point mechanism that we talked about in the beginning. Yeah, and now, let's quickly come to a brief overview here, right? On the left, we see the molecule structure, the small molecule on the top, and on the bottom is the protein that we want to bind the small molecule to. Yeah, and then we have our graph neural network that produces this point cloud, or two graph neural networks, messages inside of them and between them, and produces this point cloud. And then we construct the key points and we calculate the optimal rotation and translation between these key points, and we apply it to our point cloud or to our small molecule to predict the final structure. And then we additionally introduce these two steps to basically have our batch normalization on the coordinates, or to regularize the coordinates to always make a bit more physical sense. And we have this final projection step with which we ensure that we in the end really only change the torsion angles and have a realistic molecule structure. All right, now to how we evaluate our method. We use the standard dataset PDB-bind, which has many of these structures of experimentally determined structures of small molecules bound to their proteins, right? The 3D structures. And then we compare against four commonly used tools as baselines, which come both from industry and are also commercial tools. And then when we look at results, let's first look at some runtimes here, right? Because here in this comparison, we can almost not even see the bar for the runtime for every bind, because it is actually 1,200 times faster than the fastest baseline that we compare against. And this speed up is crucial for drug discovery, right? Where we sometimes want to search through millions of molecules and make predictions for millions of molecules. And this is possible because with Equibind, we show that a completely new paradigm is possible. And we introduced this method where we make a 3D structure prediction in a single shot. And meanwhile, all of these previous methods would always sample many, many different 3D positions and then score the 3D position and then use the best scoring one as the final prediction, right? And now this speed up is possible while maintaining quality with respect to some metrics. As we can see here, for example, where we find that the fraction of test examples for which Equibind makes a good prediction, this is similar to that of the baselines. Right? And now, let me also tell you that this protein that I showed you in the beginning, this was actually not a random protein. Rather, it was suggested to us by Pat Waters, an industry expert and leader in the field of drug discovery and molecular docking. And he suggested it to us because it is a really hard case where all of the previous methods failed. And then he went on GitHub and took our code and ran Equibind on the examples, only to find that Equibind is almost perfectly able to predict this the structure in which two important drugs bind to this protein. Now let's look at these visualizations in more detail. So here we have the ground truth, right? So we have two different drugs bound to this protein, the ground truth. And this is the structure that we would like to predict. One drug I'm always drawing in blue and the other always in red. And now here we, for example, have the prediction that one of the baselines makes. And we can see here in this image, we still have the ground truth structures in their original locations, but we additionally have the molecules and the structures as Glide predicted them. And we see that the red one isn't where the ground truth red one is, right? And the ground truth, the blue structure that Glide predicted isn't where the ground truth blue structure is. Rather, it switched the two molecules around and it put both of them in the wrong pocket, so in the wrong binding location. And then you can also look at the prediction of another baseline, and this baseline actually put both molecules into the same pocket, so it only made one wrong prediction, right? But still, it put both of them in the same pocket and couldn't determine based on the small molecule where it should end up. And meanwhile, if we use Equibind together with some fine-tuning tool, then we find that we're almost able to perfectly predict the 3D structure in which a small molecule binds to this protein. All right, and are there any questions so far?
So Hannes, can you hear me? So actually I'm totally new to these areas. So what we want to do is try to predict some like a molecule similar to or close to the ground truth, is it?
Yes. We want to predict the structure that the positions, the coordinates that the small molecule will take on. And those should be same as the ground truth.
Okay, and here we have, I see here is it could bind with plus the s. What is the s we here
have? So the plus s here means that we first make our prediction with Equibind, and then we use one of those classical tools to further fine-tune the coordinates, right? Mm-hmm. Then we have the rough position predicted by Equibind and the fine-tuning done by one of these classical methods, which samples multiple positions and then makes prediction. And this, of course, increases the runtime. Do we maybe want to look at some the results on how this increases the runtime?
Yes.
Okay, then let's go to that. Here, for example, let's go to a table. We don't have a table, actually. Let's look at the okay. Runtimes here. Then let me just tell you. So the runtime actually was 0.04 seconds, right? For predicting, making the prediction for a single complex, if we use Equibind. But now if we use Equibind S, so Equibind with the fine tuning, then it actually takes 138 seconds on average to make the prediction of a single test complex on our test data. Yeah.
It's okay. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, but then let me also quickly finish by saying that this project would not have been possible without the help of Octavian, or without my mentor Octavian, who, he recently died in May, and he was a fantastic researcher, but also a great mentor. And to honor his name, we're actually organizing the Molecular Machine Learning Conference, MOML, this October the 21st at MIT. So just in case anyone wants to submit his poster there, then we would be happy to host your posters there. And in the chat, we have the question, what is the difference of methods solving the problems between molecule protein binding and protein protein docking? So maybe you can also clarify your question while I address it a little bit in the beginning, because now one question is, do you mean just between Equidoc and Equibind the difference, like these concrete papers, or do you mean in general? So because for the more concrete one, the Equidoc versus Equibind, there we basically have the task is different. We're tackling now the small molecule case, but also in Equidoc we're only modeling the protein as a rigid body. Meanwhile, in Equibind we model the small molecule that we bind to the protein as something flexible. And this is of course important for drug discovery, because we don't know the 3D structure that the small molecule will take on during binding. We don't know any 3D structure at all, actually. Yes. Okay. And for the general case, maybe the difference between small molecule protein binding and protein protein docking is, for example, that for the protein protein case, we have quite a bit more data. And for the small molecule protein case, we also have issues like, or at least I think it is nice, a nice testbed, because we have this prior knowledge about how the small molecule will only change its torsion angles. And I think this is very nice to build into our models. But of course, on the protein side, we could maybe also do something with torsion angles by modeling the, right, in proteins, we always have these peptide bonds, and we could only model how the torsion angles between the peptide bonds change. And with approaches like this, we could maybe also build prior knowledge like the torsion angle change into protein-protein docking and have flexible protein-protein docking. And in general, also one thing is that's in our method here, right? We're not modeling the side chains and side chain flexibility of the proteins, because actually these proteins that we see right here, right? We always only see these cartoons, these green cartoons, but actually this is also just a molecule, right? And we could see many, many more 3D or many, many more small atoms sticking out of these cartoons. And we don't actually model these in our methods. And yeah, one could argue that this is a positive thing that we don't model these, because this means that we don't assume to know the rigid structure of the side chains, and the side chains are the main things that change during binding in the protein. But yeah, I think if we were to explicitly model the atoms, and we maybe explicitly model them as something flexible, then this might be a big improvement. And yeah, this is one thing that I would be very interested in for the future. But also, Equibind has other limitations. Like, for example, if we have a symmetric protein, right? And now the small molecule in our data set is found over here. But this thing is symmetric, so the small molecule might as well have bound over here, right? On the other side of the protein, because this is just as valid of a prediction. But if our model now predicts the small molecule to have bound on the other side of the protein, then we, in our loss, we would tell the small model that the model that this is wrong, and that the small molecule should actually be over here, right? So what is the best prediction that the model can make to minimize the average prediction error? So the best thing would be to put the small molecule in the middle, which does not make sense at all, right? Here, the small molecule would never go. Yeah, so we're now also looking at approaches to alleviate this problem and to model this in a more, the binding problem in a more principled manner, I would say. Yeah, and also I think maybe it is necessary to have sort of an iterative approach where we refine the position or more and more the position of the small molecule, because yeah, I think this is how it physically happens, right? We don't just have suddenly the small molecule here appearing. We want to be able to reason about the distances between the small molecule and the protein, and the forces between them, and how the small molecule would move if it is at a certain location. And also, there's not just one location that the small molecule can end up in. There's a distribution with different probabilities where the small molecule could end up. And having a model like this, that would be very valuable, right? Like a model that can tell us the distribution of positions of the small molecule and yeah, accurately model this. Okay, but then yes. I talked quite a bit about future work as well, but yeah, if any of you have concrete questions, please go ahead. Otherwise, if you're interested and want to know more about proteins and see some visualizations of proteins themselves, for example, we could also look at that, because I don't know what the backgrounds here are exactly. And if you just want to hear more a little bit about proteins themselves, then I would also be happy to chat about that. But yeah.
Yes. Okay, Hannes. Maybe I still ask some questions. So I see here. Seems that in your lab is quite a lot of people working on the like molecular or AI for the drugs. So do we like work? How do we cooperate with the industry? So we share the code for them, or how to use?
Oh well. Okay. So first of all, I think definitely. Share, putting your code online and how you train okay. your model and how you and the code for inference, I think that's just something that you have to do if you publish a paper for others to reproduce, or being able to reproduce your results and see that your model actually does what you claim that it does. And if you do that, of course, then that's also super helpful for people who want to use that tool. Yeah, but now more to how we collaborate with industry. So, yeah, I think so my humble opinion here, right? Because I'm also not a, I haven't collaborated with industry for
Yes.
10 years.
Okay.
My humble opinion here is that, or at least what I've seen so far is that we can, or we as researchers, we really have to, yeah, talk to the people from industry to find out what actually are the important problems. And if I were to now develop a machine learning model that solves this task, this and that task perfectly, would this actually be of any use at all in the real world? Because it's, yeah, maybe we've seen certain cases in the past where we've tackled some problems and try to solve them with machine learning, and then we see nice numbers for these tasks, and then yeah, we find out that for the people from the industry, or for the people for who we assume that these tools would actually be useful in the end in the real world, they can't actually do anything with it at all, because yeah, we just went into a completely wrong direction, or our task, the way that we approached the task was limited in some fashion that would not make it useful for practical application. But with that, we also, of course, always have to keep in mind that it's an incremental process, right? And that we probably don't propose them. And with Equivine, we also definitely don't generate, we definitely now don't have the method that solves binding structure prediction, right? And yeah, there are definitely many steps to further improve this, but I think the value that I see in Equibind, or one of the biggest values that I see in Equibind, is showing that this paradigm is possible of making a really fast prediction with machine learning, and that people should maybe explore this direction as well, instead of only having these scoring functions and sampling many, many positions. Maybe they are right. What people always did is that you take a 3D structure, and now if you want to do something with machine learning or try a machine learning approach, then they just had the machine the score function be like a 3D CNN that's uses machine learning methods to produce a score of this 3D position. But maybe there are completely other approaches like this that we could take that are also promising, and that we really should invest some thoughts into, and try to develop as well.
Yes. I think here I also have a few questions about
Yes.
yeah. One is both said that
Okay.
can this method be applied on the molecular discovery from the herb or something else?
I don't know what it means to do molecule discovery from herb, and I also don't know what flavone is. So maybe let's wait for some clarification in the chat on that
Okay.
and tackle the next question in the
Yes.
meantime. Another question is there any connection between Equibind with AlphaFold, since AlphaFold has a new version for predicting protein complex? Yeah. So the AlphaFold does this co-folding, I think, right? And there's, for example, AlphaFold Multimer, where you basically have multiple proteins together, and you so what some people have done as well is to then just put a little line of amino acids between those two proteins, and then see how AlphaFold predicts the folding. Or the 3D structure of the protein, then we remove that little line again, and that is then our final docked prediction. Yeah, so in terms of that, there's I would say that there's little connection between methods like Equidoc and right Equidoc tackles protein-protein binding and AlphaFold. But for example, AlphaFold also uses these directional features for where a side chain points, for the orientation of a side chain, right? And we also use those in Equidoc and in Equibind. Yeah, and Then I don't know about Flavone. Do we want to clarify that question? Otherwise, maybe, I mean, we can also
Yes, I
the
think
full.
what he want to ask is that it is possible the same like algorithm can be applied to some molecule for the herb. Oh, Flavone. Yes, I don't know what is Flavone is. I think it's one
Yeah,
kind
I
of
mean, of course.
yeah.
Yeah, you can apply it to any small molecule. Yes. Yeah, you could apply it to molecules that are present in some herbs as well. But the question is, right? Maybe this molecule is very different from all the molecules that we trained on, and then the prediction that we make might be a little bit worse. But we also made some evaluations between the correlation of the Tanimoto similarity between two molecules. So let's just say between the correlation of the similarity between molecules and the mean and the RMSD that we're getting for the predictions. And we found that the similarity for the small molecule was not so important. So the similarity to our test set was not our training set was not important for the performance. So there was very little correlation. So this might indicate that yeah, we actually are able to generalize very pretty well. And the if our predictions are good for our test set, then the predictions. The predictions might just be just as good for Flavone, for example, this molecule.
Yes.
Then I have two questions. One is that what is the correlation between docking post and docking scores produced by Acrivine? Can this be connected to binding free energy? Well, this is actually a very interesting, right? A very, very good question. But Acrivine doesn't actually not produce a docking score at all. So it does not give you a score. You ca cannot use it to do molecular, like to screen through a million molecules and yeah, predict whether or not or which of those molecules is the most likely to bind. Right? Here we only predict the 3D structure. And well, so I think predicting 3D structures is an important step towards predicting binding affinities or binding free energies, but the binding free energy task is not addressed in Acrivine, right? So, yeah, we could now go ahead and make predictions on top of the 3D structures that Acrivine predicts for the binding free energy, for example. But I also think that we still need better 3D structure predictions to then go ahead and make binding free energy predictions. And also that the right yeah, this really is just an incremental step towards improving our binding predictions, and this is not a solution, right? So the task is not completely solved. But then the second question that you mentioned is, as you have mentioned, kinase is usually hard to find docking position, and what else protein targets are difficult in this case of docking task? So I think the question here is, if I have other ideas of proteins. That are hard to bind to, but no, I can't provide you there with like specific or for which classical docking tools fail most of the time. But I can't provide you now with a specific protein name. But I just think if you have a very large protein, right, then you have many possible positions where a small molecule could bind, and then the task becomes harder, for example. Also, if you have a super small molecule, then might have a high, I think, what we call promiscuity, right? That it just binds everywhere. And then it's also yeah, not so easy to predict where this small molecule actually binds. And also in our data, we always only see one location, right? And this might not be, or this is not necessarily the right location of the small molecule binding, right? Because it is a distribution of a probability distribution of over where the small molecule binds. And maybe another 3D structure prediction is just as good. So having a generative model that models the whole distribution of where a small molecules binds and the probability accurately reflects the probabilities of where a small molecule would go, this would be extremely valuable. And yeah, then maybe I would get to, is it an E3 equivalent graph neural network? Yes. So the networks that we're using is the EGNN, right? The graph neural networks that we're using are EGNNs, so equivariant graph neural networks. And yeah, you can look up that paper where they introduced this method, and we just have one operating on the small molecule, one operating on the protein, and we also pass messages between them. This is basically the how the EGNN is changed, and we also make a few little tweaks, but in principle those are two EGNNs. And so maybe as a quick introduction to EGNNs, for those who haven't heard them about them, they basically use the pairwise distance, or they use the distances between atoms in their message passing. And they additionally always update the atom coordinates based on the features in an E3 equivariant way. All right.
Then, thanks for your answer.
Hi. Could you hi. Yes.
You can start. Hi. Yes. Hi. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes. Did you mind to?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I can just use the audio one.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So, thank you for your answers. I have asked questions about the binding free energy, and also I want to add an additional question about the allosteric point binding site. Can you predict the allosteric binding site for just like the GPCR, G protein coupled receptor, or the other receptors?
Okay, so is the question if we're sometimes able to predict allosteric binding sites with equibind?
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe for everyone, in proteins, we sometimes, and please correct me if I say something inaccurate here, right? We want to get it right. But in proteins, do I understand, we sometimes have multiple binding sites, and or multiple of these main binding sites, right? And sometimes we have an orthosteric binding site, so where the main interaction point of the protein is, and where the main molecule that interacts with it usually goes. And then we have like a secondary allosteric binding site where something in addition binds. And now let's maybe go here. In this example, right here, for example, the blue molecule is actually bound in the orthosteric, so in the main binding site of this protein, and while the red one is bound in the allosteric binding site. And actually, how this protein works usually is that it takes the blue molecule, which is ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which you might have heard about. This is like the energy, an energy storage molecule in our body. It binds to this position, and then the protein goes ahead and pulls off a phosphate of this ATP and turns it into ADP and attaches it to another protein. And then the other protein is activated. Let's say it like that. And this is the main interaction that this protein has with this blue molecule binding into the main binding site. And meanwhile, the red molecule goes into the allosteric binding site. And actually, the function of the protein is such that the protein is only activated if the red molecule I'm not sure if that's correct. No, but yeah, anyway, this is the point that I want to make, right? Because DDDD, five times D, in chat here, is there, are we sometimes able to predict the binding structure of allosteric binding sites? And here we have such an example, right? And exactly this, where the red molecule is bound to the allosteric binding site or to the secondary binding site. And we can see in this that we are actually able in this particular case, right, to predict the binding site. But this case is also not cherry picked, right? It was just suggested to us from Pat, by Pat Waters.
Okay, thank you. So I know that the if I understand correctly, that you means that the red one is the modulator, and only with the modulator bind to the protein, then the protein is activated.
I did not quite catch the question based on the audio, but I think I understood what you're asking is for a clarification of what we're actually showing here. And then maybe the answer would be that the in the right image, we still have the ground truth structures shown. But in addition to the ground truth structures, we also have in the same colors for the individual molecules, in the same colors where the prediction was made. So for the red one here, you, for example, can see that there's the original red position and where our model predicted the red molecule to go, also in red, in a little bit lighter red. Is that what you asked for?
Okay. So I want to know that the allosteric site is predicted by ranking the distribution of the docking scores, or how can you get the allosteric point?
No. It's not predicted by any ranking. The prediction here is made by we take the protein structure as input and we take the red molecule as input without its 3D structure. And then we just predict that the red molecule goes where we predicted it to go. And that's what the model does, our method does.
Thank you. I got the
Thank you for the nice questions. This is a very nice discussion so far, I have to say.
Yes. Okay, any further questions from the audience? Yeah.
Great. Then okay. I want to say some finishing words and just thank you all for the nice discussion. And I want to tell you to definitely stay, because now there is another awesome presentation by Xiang, who has a paper.
Yes, maybe I think we can just spend 1 or 2 minutes. I think you should introduce your reading group to us, right? So actually, Hannes have an awesome reading group. I think it's worth for us to, if you have time, because in previous, I think you are voting for the new time slot, right? So the previous one usually like mid time for the Chinese, for the Beijing time. So, but
yeah,
I think we can
actually,
share. I think we can have a look at the awesome that reading group organized by Hannes.
I'd be of course happy to advertise my reading group. But yeah, this is the learning on graphs and geometry reading group, where we each Tuesday we meet at. For example, 3 p.m. UTC. So each week at the same time we meet and we discuss a recent paper from Learning on Graphs and Geometry that we found on archive and think is interesting. Yeah, and there the most of the times we have the authors of the paper as well. And yeah, you can just, if you want to stay updated, can just Google my name, for example, and on my website you find the reading group here. And then you can, for example, join our Slack or join our mailing list to stay updated. Yeah. All right. Thanks for that opportunity. And then thank you, Stanley.
Yes. Stanley is a professor in the Westlake University of China. Yes.
Thanks, Professor.
He works on the computer vision before, but right now, I have some time to focus on on the molecular or AI for the drugs and so on.
Okay, cool. Then any other points, or should we get to Xi'an?